good morning. This is a great day. Easter and wow. It's God came through and God is faithful and God is awesome. And we're going to praise God today. Thank you if you're joining us online. And thank you if you were able to come and join us today. It's a great day wherever you are. So thank you. I have a question and maybe you can help me. Do you know where the Easter Bunny ate breakfast? Well, at the IHOP, of course. All right. But more importantly, and you can check me on this one, where did the risen Jesus eat breakfast? According to John chapter 21, verse 4, Jesus had breakfast, and this is a little while after Easter, but it's the risen Jesus. Jesus has breakfast. This is why I love Jesus. Jesus is my kind of guy. Jesus has breakfast at the shore. On the Sea of Galilee, he's on the beach there. Now, he's a little different than I am. I don't know what you had for breakfast, but Jesus has breakfast with his disciples. And you know if he's having breakfast with Peter, you know what he's having? Fish. Anybody have fish for breakfast today? Well, and again, in case you're wondering, John chapter 21, verse 12 says, Jesus is saying to his disciples, and you're his disciples, and we have fish for y'all after church today. He literally says, come and have breakfast. So obviously we can't do that right now in a safe and healthy way, but who knows? Maybe soon. So I just wanted to ask you, first of all, we want to thank you for getting the flowers. And we have a list up here, and please take them home, because after the service, we want your house to be beautiful, or we want you to give them out to somebody. So we have a list up here. If you forgot what you ordered, oh, it was up there. Or we have a list here, and you can figure it out. And I can't even tell what, I know a tulip, but after that, I'm a little lost. But I'll get some people to help me. But take your plants, take them home, and if you want to check it off or whatnot. But anyway, thank you for everyone who ordered. And I'd like to personally take this time and thank Joanne for also, obviously, for her awesome playing. And you're about to hear the organ. But she makes the place look beautiful. And also Kathy Ditterer, she cut flowers around there. So thank you for that. And Karen also helped with the flowers. So again, for everyone, whether you helped us have them here and all, it just makes it so much beautiful. Now, here's the real important question on Easter. If you get three strikes, is that good or bad? Yeah, see, Marianne knows. It depends. I didn't say whether it was baseball or bowling. Now, our bowling team, we're only in second place now. It's a tough week. Third, oh, geez. We're falling. But let me tell you the good news. Now, you know what a split is in bowling, where the pins are separated. And it's like, oh, my gosh, how do you get that? On Tuesday night, we had four splits. Now, we have more than four splits. But the Tabor United Methodist Church team, successfully knocked down four splits. And if you want to know, I have it on film. Because the team is awesome. Cindy Frick. The place goes crazy. She knocks down the split. Now, again, we asked about the three strikes. Well, what about six strikes? Did you ever see anybody get a strike? Next, get a strike. Get a strike. Six times. You're trying to keep cool because you're literally looking up the score, and that's a perfect score. Our very own Reverend Marianne Ditter. Six strikes in a row. And I confess, I bowl before her, and I think I messed up the lane. She only got six. But out of the whole game, I think she's only missed four pins, and she did that two games in a row. Not the six strikes, but I mean, I think she only missed four pins in two games. So, and we're only in third place. Maybe there's a weak link on the team. But anyway, again, we'll just want to get, we're not here to talk about bowling. We're so glad to see everyone. We're so glad it's Easter. We, again, are grateful for the flowers. And today is communion. It's the first Sunday of the month. So at home, if you have a chance to get some bread or get some juice, if you're here and you don't have it yet, we have communion right there in the back as you came in. So we hope everyone has had a chance to get communion because we're going to be doing that in the service. So I don't have any other announcements. Does anybody else have an announcement? Yes. Oh, yeah. Okay, in case for people at home maybe couldn't hear that because the microphone's over in the pew. But anyway, the Tabor Hill Nursery School flower sale, which happens every year, just in time for Mother's Day, but we need the forms in. You got it in the Tabor Herald that was mailed out. And if you're not getting that, let me know because we want you to get it. It's a great ministry. There's Mary Ann's article is worth the price of it alone. It's free. But anyway, it's in that, and we also have it in the back here, or we can email it to you. Okay, so it has been sent out in an email, so we got to have it in 2 weeks. Okay, so thank you for that. Any other announcements? Betty? Kids, okay, we need small tubes of toothpaste, not big ones, small tubes. For the ugly quilts. Okay, thank you for that. All right, well, is anybody here to worship God? All right, well, I know when it's time to worship God. We're going to Reverend Ditter to help us worship God. Would you help us, Mary Ann?
Good morning. Please join me in the call to worship. You have turned our mourning into dancing. You have taken away our funeral clothes and reclothed us in joy so that our whole being, body, mind, and soul might sing praise to you and not be silent. O Lord, our Lord, we will give thanks to you forever. Alleluia, Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Darkness has been vanquished. The brilliant light of hope has come. Come, let us worship and celebrate the good news. Alleluia. Christ is risen. Amen. Please join in our opening hymn, Christ the Lord is risen today. Thank you. an amen?
Amen.
Let us pray. Thank you, Jesus, for setting us free. Your death on the cross conquered sin and death. You also opened up a way for us to have direct access to you. We are free to talk to you and spend time in your presence. We also have the opportunity to hear from you. Don't let us take this for granted, Lord, but keep encouraging us and drawing us to you so that we can be the people you desire us to be. What peace and comfort this brings as we face challenging times. We ask you to speak to our hearts as we come to worship and praise your name in celebration of your resurrection. Let us feel the joy of this day of celebration. Fill us with your spirit so that we can experience all that you have for us today and as we continue to walk closely with you. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
All righty. So do we have any kids out there? Oh, yeah. It's kids of all ages, right, on Easter. Who's still getting an Easter basket? Hey, it's all right. It's Easter, right? Heck yeah. But kids, I want you to know that Easter is full of surprises. Now, I know... Back row, did you find a surprise when you came to church today? Yeah, so that's a kind of a neat surprise. And I'm not saying nothing. But maybe you found some surprises at home when you woke up this morning. Because Easter is about surprises. But the biggest surprise of all is that on Friday, Jesus died on the cross. And perhaps you have a grandparent or somebody else you know that has no longer with us, and that makes us sad. And of course, we would be really sad the day Jesus died. But then Easter, kids, surprise! Jesus is saying, I'm alive! I'm not dead! And that's like the greatest surprise of all. And you know, it's Jesus' physical body. Put on your thinking cap now, because this is a... Jesus has a physical body, but kind of what we get some of the language and what's happening on Easter, we use the word resurrection a lot, and Jesus' body kind of transformed from his normal body into a resurrected body, a little different because he came back to life, and he changed from a physical body into a resurrected body, and I'm like, how does that work? And that's a good question. And I'm like, just thinking about it, Paul, I get a headache. And then I remember, in nature, God gives us an example of something that changes form into something else. And I know you're thinking already of what it is. And I don't have a caterpillar here, so that's okay. Maybe next year, okay? But this year I have something else, and we'll see if it works. And for you at home, you let me know. I got your very own one. If you're here, I'm going to give you some, or I'll put them on the table, or if anybody else wants to take some. So we have some of these if it works, because sometimes things don't always work, and that's okay. But anyway... A fuzzy worm with legs. A caterpillar. Did you ever see a caterpillar? Yeah, they're kind of fun to watch. Anybody scared of the caterpillar? Well, but what happens to the caterpillar? The caterpillar at some point looks like it dies. Looks like it goes almost into its own tomb. It makes a cocoon. And if we were watching that cocoon, we'd say, like, I'm not sure if it's alive. I don't see the caterpillar anymore. And you know, you're smart, you know, and I'm going to see if it works. After a while, eventually something comes out of that cocoon, and it's not a caterpillar, it's something else. And that caterpillar goes through a big word, what we call metamorphosis, meaning it changed its form. And that's kind of the way I like to think of it, is that as Jesus, his form changed from a physical body to a resurrected body. And God says, the good news is the same thing is going to happen to you. Because when you get a resurrected body, the good news is you're going to live forever and ever and ever. Now, here we go. Do you think it's going to work? Well, here's the thing. Normally, and we'll try it with this one. Normally, I wind this baby up because, you know, I want this one to fly out there and scare somebody in the here at church. But as I kept practicing it last night, it kept breaking. Yeah, and that's not good. So, and if it breaks on you, and again, you just need a new rubber band. You can see there's two hooks in there and a little rubber band. And I think even in the packs, they give you extra ones. So let's just try this other one here. And a little better. Don't trip on that, Mary. Okay. Well, let's pray for your kids. We thank you, Lord, for our kids. They are a blessing. Lord, we pray, and we would love to have so many more kids. Lord, please hear our prayer. But Lord, we're praying for our kids right now. And even though this is a super duper day and we're having a lot of fun, we know that it's not always fun, that sometimes it's tough. And we know that they are going through something that none of us have ever had to go through. So, Lord, we're praying for our kids. May they know that they are loved. May they know that we understand that it's hard and that they're not alone and that God is with you and God cares about what you're going through and that you can talk with us and let us know how you feel. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, now with the other kids, would you like some fun? All right, let's try this out. Let's see how this works. Get my singing voice. Christ the Lord is risen today. All right. Good. How about this one? There's a story. Okay, well, you get it. And that proves the point of my sermon, okay? And you're like, what? It's Easter, Pastor Ed. Hold that thought, and we're going to get back to it. But that's the point of the sermon. That's the point of Mark's Easter story. I'll even give that much to you. But anyway, so here we are. We're going through a different time, you know, and we don't like that. But it is what it is. What are we going to do? And we're making the best of the situation, whether you're online or whether you come to our outdoor service or whether you came to the service on the sunrise and we were outside. We're doing whatever we can, but it's a different Easter. And you've heard that term before. You're like, I'm tired of hearing that term because we had a different Christmas. And Easter last year was really different. And we're working on it. But at Christmas, we had fun. We said, well, if it's going to be a different Christmas, let's make it a different Christmas. And we studied a different Christmas story, same Christmas story, but we went to another scripture that maybe you weren't familiar with. We did the genealogy of Matthew. Woohoo! Many people fell asleep. Do not drive when you're listening to the genealogy of Matthew. You will, but if you can't fall asleep at night, read the genealogy of Matthew. And the good Lord is going to help you out. But we're not going to put you to sleep today, but we're going to have a different scripture, perhaps, than you're used to. The typical scripture, what we have is Mary Magdalene and the women, and they're coming to the tomb, and they're going to finish the preparation. You know that Easter story. And they get there, and the rocks moved away. And they go in, and there's an angel. And then they go and get Peter and John. And then they come, and then they leave. Then Mary Magdalene stays behind. And then Mary Magdalene goes into the tomb. And she sees somebody there, and she says, you know, where did you take the body? Tell me, and I'd love to go get the body. And, you know, because a body's missing. This is a horrible thing. And the guy says, why are you looking for a living among the dead? And then she turns around, and maybe, we're not sure, maybe the gardener has his back to her. We're not sure, but she doesn't recognize the gardener. She assumes he's the gardener because it's a garden tomb. And she says to the gardener, you know, have you taken a body? Let us know, where is it? And he says, Mary. And something maybe he said that so many times to her, or the way she said it, and she recognized Mary. And maybe you have a special way that when you're talking to God and God speaks to you and calls your name, and maybe you never audibly heard it, but I pray that you have heard it in your heart when God calls your name, because God is calling your name. And Mary heard it, and her day was changed. She went from the worst day to the best day ever. And, you know, so you know the rest of that Easter story. That's our traditional Easter story. But we want a different Easter story right now. Well, in our lectionary, we're going through the book of Mark. And we're in Mark gets his Easter story. And it's the gospel. It's not John. Okay? It's a different, he presents the gospel in a different way, the Easter story. Perhaps in the light of the John story, maybe it's not as satisfactory. And we'll read it in a second. I don't want to keep teasing you with this. But, and don't get me wrong, if you look at each gospel story, you're going to say, of the Easter story, you're going to say, Pastor Ed, we got a problem. There's some contradictions here. This one says there was one woman. This Arthur says there was four women. This one says there's two angels. This one says there's one angel. This one says they went back. If you were to ask somebody, they said, I saw Pastor Ed going to the church at 7 a.m. on Sunday. And somebody else would say, no. I seen Pastor Ed going to church on Sunday at 8 a.m. Now, is that a contradiction? Perhaps at first light. But maybe Pastor Ed came to church twice that morning. Okay, and then is that a contradiction? Are both people telling a true story? Yes, it's just different details. I didn't tell my story. Other people were telling my story. Now, what if I was at church and I'm talking to Boyd? And that's a fact. I say, hey, Boyd, how you doing? And then somebody else says, well, wait a minute. I saw Pastor Ed talking to Reverend Ditter. Now, is that a contradiction? No, they're just different details of the story. And each person's giving certain details of the story. So when you see the different gospel stories of Easter, they're not a contradiction. And if you really see, like, I can't see how you piece them together, let me know. We have a document where it takes each gospel and each story, and I can show you where they all come together and you can get the big picture. But that's not for this Sunday. Okay, we're going to leave that hanging. But we're going to just want you to let you know, we're going to give you the scripture now that I've teased you enough about it. This Mark chapter 16, verses 1 through 8. He tells his whole Easter story in 8 verses. Verse 1, when the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, Salome, or is it Salami? No one would call their daughter Salami, or would they? And Salome bought spices so that they might go to anoint Jesus' body. Very early on the first day of the week, Sunday, just after sunrise, maybe we should have the sunrise service later. Just after sunrise, but the verse we read in John says it was still dark, so that's the problem. Just after sunrise, they were on their way to the tomb, and they asked each other, who will roll the stone away from the entrance of the tomb? But when they looked up, they saw the stone, which was very large. It had been rolled away. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe, sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. Now, my texting buddies, I think that's okay if you capitalize that. They were alarmed. You'd be alarmed. But in verse 6, the guy says, don't be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus the Nazarene, who was crucified. He has risen. Remember that. We're almost at the end of his Easter story. He has risen. So it's in there. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. Verse 7, important verse. But go, tell his disciples and Peter, he is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you. Trembling and bewildered, the women went out and fled from the tomb. They said nothing to anyone because, even though what the guy said, they're still afraid. Quite understandably. So that's it. That's Mark's Easter story. I don't know if you catch it or not. We don't even get to see the risen Jesus in it. And the other ones you do. We have an Easter story with no Jesus walking, nothing from Jesus, not a word from Jesus other than what the angel's saying, what Jesus had said earlier. Are you satisfied? And I'm going to tell you, you're not supposed to be satisfied. And you're like, what kind of story is that? I'm going to tell you, I believe it's intentional that Mark left you unsatisfied, that he doesn't give you the appearance, that it's supposed to be a little disconcerting, that it seems unfinished, and that, you know, and we want things to be wrapped up nice and neatly. We want to resolve this story. And so it's almost like somebody singing, Christ the Lord is risen today. It would bother you not to finish that. We want to finish things. There was a legend of a composer. Can you imagine a composer who was lazy? He didn't want to wake up in the morning. So his wife would walk over to the piano and go, hit the keys. I'm going to sing them, okay, because I don't play piano. But she hit the keys. Do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, ti. And she'd walk away. And he's a composer. And it's driving him crazy. He's trying to let it go. He's trying not to let it bother him. But we have to have resolution. We have to have something finished. And it's in him. And he gets out of bed and he walks over to the piano and he hits do. He completes it because we want things to be finished. And to be honest, this technique in the Bible, and the Bible's a literary work, it's the Word of God, it's the inspired Word of God. There's different literary devices. There's poetry, there's prophecy, there's history, there's all kinds of things in the Bible. And this is a literary device that even Jesus himself uses. Perhaps you remember the story of the prodigal son. He tells you all about the prodigal son. He's done wrong. He realized he's done wrong. He's come back. And that we have resolution to. But then there's the older brother. And if we're to say the older brother might be like, now we're all the prodigal, don't get me wrong. But sometimes maybe we're like the older brother where I've lived a good life. I've always done what the father said. And I can't stand that stinking brother of mine. He just does everything wrong, and I will not celebrate with my younger brother. Even the father comes out and says, everything I have is yours. Come in, celebrate. That which was lost is now found. Your brother, we may have never seen him again. He's back in the family. Come and celebrate. And Jesus ends the story, and we're like, does the brother go in or not? And it's intentional. Jesus is leaving that uneasiness, the unresolved issue, because he wants you to feel uncomfortable, because he wants you to answer the question. Are you going to forgive? Are you going to swallow your pride? Are you going to humble yourself and reconcile with everyone in church? Even those that might not look like us, even those that might be different than us, we're all a church family. So Jesus did it, and Mark's doing it here. And that's what he wants to do. And this story that seems unfinished, I believe it's intentional. Because he wants you to finish the story. Remember verse 6 I told you. He said, he is risen. And in the very next verse 7, he says, go and tell. So there's his Easter story. He knows, he said he's risen. Okay, fact, check it off. But what's our response to that? He's risen. The guy told us, go and tell. And I know you're like, oh, I hate these sermons when they tell me to do this stuff. Because you know what, Pastor Ed, I'm shy and I'm not social. All right. Or whatever. And I get it. But good news. We are a church family. And I say that with all my heart, whether you got up here and took a vow, whether you give money or not. If you say, I'm part of the church family, you are part of the church family. You are my brother. You are my sister. We have the same father. And as I like to say for my son, who says, we're all brothers and sisters. All right, I'm going to mess this up. We're brothers with a different mother. I don't know. I'll fix it next week. Okay. Brother, a brother from another mother, right? A sister from another mother. Brother. We have different mothers. We have the same heavenly father. Okay. All right. Anyway, back to the sermon. We have a church family with all different gifts, with people that are comfortable in doing different things. We have people who love to bake. And we have people who love to do whatever. And I'd be happy. Well, kind of what I want is, do you know what Jesus did when he went to start his ministry? He started inviting people and hanging out with people. Now, I know you're doing that already. Even though you're antisocial, even though we're in a pandemic, you're online. So we're dealing with people. Now, let me ask you. Would you like to invite somebody to a comedy night? Even if it's online or in person when we can? How about a game night? And we can do that online or in person. How about a Tabor art gallery? Would you invite somebody to Tabor where we all bring out artwork that we've done and people could come out and say, would you feel comfortable inviting somebody out like Jesus did? Just saying, hey, I'm going to this. Anybody else want to come? And maybe when the time comes, would you like to come and shoot basketball? Can God use basketball? Oh, you've never been to Tabor before, have you? How many kids we getting out on Tuesday nights before all this nonsense? 20 kids. That's good for a church in today's world. I'll take 20. And here's the deal. God can use basketball. God can use a movie. God can use art. God's going to use whatever to get people to come in and in a friendly, gently way by them seeing that we're not weird, we're not drinking Kool-Aid, that we're nice and friendly people, and that we are the way we are because we know Jesus. And just by us having a relationship with them, and maybe they listen to a sermon, and maybe they hear Pastor Ed saying that if you believe in Jesus as your Lord and Savior, if you recognize that you're a sinner, that no, we have this verse, John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his son, that whoever believed in him, that will not perish but have eternal life. He died for our sins, we said, on Good Friday, and you will have eternal life. So that's what I'm saying. It's easy enough to invite people, and that's what we're about. We're about getting to know people. We're getting about, it's written on our window, we want to make disciples for Jesus Christ. Because as Easter says, it can change your life forever and ever and ever. So as the seasons come on, and I know we're in the middle of a pandemic, we're going to make the best of it. And maybe, as my wife likes to tell me, maybe the pandemic is our downtime so we can get ready when things open up, that then we're ready to hit the road running and we can still reach out and in new ways and creative ways that God's opening up and make disciples of Jesus Christ. Okay, so that makes me want to sing a song. Thine Be the Glory, hymn number 308. It's about a risen, conquering son. Does anybody know hymn number 308? Have you heard it before? Are you going to... So let's now say, thine be the glory. endless is the victory. Do you like hearing the organ? Oh, amen. Well, at this time, we like to do communion. So again, we just want to make sure that everyone here, if not in the back, we have our communion cup with the bread on top and the juice. Or if you're at home, bread or cracker and the juice. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is a right and a good and a joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with all your people on earth and all of those in the company of heaven, and if I may say, Lillian Mulger is having Easter in heaven today, not in some health care center, not in some senior center, but in heaven today. So when we say that, with all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join with them in their unending hymn of praise. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Father. Hosanna in the highest. Holy and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection on Easter, you gave birth to your church. You delivered us from the slavery of sin and death, and you made with us a new covenant by water and by the Spirit. And then on the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread and gave thanks to the Father. He broke the bread. He gave it to his disciples. And he said, take and eat it. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Now, we're going to wait until the end to do both together, okay? Like we would for communion. When the supper was over, he took the cup. And again, he gave thanks to the Father. He gave it to his disciples. And he said, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant. It will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so in remembrance of these mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and a living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering to us as we proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ is done. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on all of us gathered here, on all those watching online, whether it is now or whether it is in the future. Lord, we know that you are not constrained by technology. Pour out your Holy Spirit on all of us here and on these gifts of the bread and the juice. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, who have been redeemed by the blood of Christ. By your Holy Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, one in ministry to all the world, until Jesus Christ comes in his final victory. And at that point, we will feast at his heavenly banquet through your Son, Jesus Christ, and with the Holy Spirit, and with your holy church. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now with confidence, we come and we say, take your bread, your wafer, or your bread at home. Jesus said, "This is my body, which has been broken for you. Let us eat the bread and remember what Jesus did for us. He died on the cross for us. Let's eat now in remembrance of him. Do this in memory of me." And if you're able to open your cup, he said, "This is my blood, which has been poured out for you. We have sinned." And the Bible says, the wages of sin is death. And Jesus didn't want us to die forever. Our physical body will die. We talked about it with the kids. But we're going to have a resurrected body. And Jesus said, "I didn't want heaven to be without you. So I'm going to come to earth. I'm going to die for your sins on the cross so that your penalty is paid, because the wages of sin is death." And Jesus, who lived a perfect life, took on all the sins of the world, so that when we believe in Jesus, we're accepting the invitation that he died for our sins, and then he takes our sins and he gives us his righteousness. When our time comes, and we're no longer here with a heartbeat, when we're no longer breathing, God will look upon us. He will not see the things that we have done. He will see Jesus in our heart. He will see Jesus' righteousness in us. And this is a sign of the new covenant, that Jesus wants to trade your sins for his righteousness. So now, in memory of what Jesus has done, let us never forget that he gave his life by showing us the shedding of his blood. Let us now drink of the cup. May we go forth in peace. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion, coming into union, of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen. I'd like to continue this reverent and holy moment as a time to pray. So we would ask Reverend Ditter to come up and to lead us in prayer.
This is a time in our service where we have an opportunity to share with one another any prayer concerns that we might have, or to give testimony as to the ways we have seen God moving in our lives. We have a couple of concerns that we know about in the church family. We would like to continue prayer for Ken. He's still trying to get off the trach and breathing on his own and kind of has his ups and downs, so continued prayer for him. Of course, continued prayer for the family of Lil Mauger, who just passed away last week. And so prayer for comfort for them. Also, Jenny Schmidt's Aunt Marge, I don't know if you saw that on the prayer chain, but she had been in the hospital for COVID and was struggling with that, came home, was doing okay, and then had kind of a mini stroke, and so prayer for her as she's in the hospital. Also, one of the people that watches online, Ramona Kim, she's been in pain and has been in the hospital as well, so prayer for her. And Amy Gearhart's mother, she's been struggling with different health issues, but now has been diagnosed with COVID. She's doing fine, but of course, she is in the hospital and doing fine, but of course she's still scared about other symptoms coming up. And then apparently Amy's son also got COVID, and he's only, a couple years old, yeah. So prayer for her mom, her mom and her son. So do we have any others that you would like to be lifted up this morning?
Brother Willie Cressman had COVID, and he's in a nursing home. And, well, he's 88, and he was strong as an ox, and they have to help him to bed. And we're asking prayer for his therapy.
I just like continued prayers for Nadja House, Charlie House's daughter. She's still in a really rough financial situation. She's feeling pretty down. So if you could just keep her in prayer. Thanks.
I had previously asked for prayers for Melita because she had foot surgery, and I am happy to say she's made it through the surgery, is healing well, and everything is good. So thank you for the prayers.
Okay. All right, let's go before the Lord. Lord God, we just thank you that you are here with us, and you know our hearts and the concerns that are on our hearts. Lord, we lift up several people to you this morning. We lift up Ken and ask that you would continue his healing and that he could get off that trach and breathing on his own and come home soon. So be with him, surround him and Carol as they walk through this time. Also, Lord, we ask that you would be with the family of Lil and that you would give them comfort and peace as they walk through this time of mourning. And just help them to remember how strong Lil's faith was, and she's now celebrating in heaven. So let that be a comfort to them as they walk through this time. We also lift up Ginny's Aunt Marge to you and just ask for her healing to take place and be with her daughter as well as they, as she watches her mom having to go through this hospital visit again. And just surround them both, but especially have Aunt Marge come through this with no problems. Lord, we lift up Amy's mother to you and, of course, her son, who both have been diagnosed with COVID, and just ask that you would provide the healing for them. We also lift up William Cressman. Lord, we know there are so many people that we know that have gone through COVID, and some have had minor symptoms and others serious symptoms, and we just lift them all before you, Lord, and just ask that you would provide a healing for them so that they can be home and returning to what they were doing before. Lord, we also lift up Nadja to you and just ask that you would surround her with peace as she continues to struggle, and I just pray that you would put people in her path like Leanne to just encourage her and find ways to help her through this. Lord, we also lift up Ramona to you, and we just ask that you would give the doctors wisdom for what they're going, what they're finding, and that they can just help her and cure her so that she would no longer be in pain. And Lord, we do praise you when we hear good reports, and so we just thank you for Melita's healing and ask that you can continue to provide for her and help her to sense you in the midst of all of this. Lord, we know that there are other concerns that are on our hearts that might not have been mentioned this morning, and so we lift them before you as well. Lord, we thank you that you are there always with us walking through our difficulties, and we just thank you for that and ask that you would just, in certain cases, make your presence known just to people that are just struggling and just can't seem to handle it on their own. Help them to just sense you and your love for them through this. Lord, we also lift up the leadership of this church and ask that you would continue to speak to our hearts so that we may be doing the work that you've asked each of us to do. We ask all of this in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We continue to not formally take an offering, but just want to encourage you, if you desire, there are offering plates at the back of the sanctuary where you can place your offering. We also are very grateful for those who have sent offering through the mail and paid electronically, whether it's through our website or PayPal. And we really are grateful for your continued generosity to the church and to help us continue with the ministry that God is calling us to do. So thank you for that. And so we're just going to sing in reminder and praise to God for all the blessings that he has given us, especially during this time. You know, no matter where our background has been in the past, these songs, Jesus Christ is risen today and he lives, have been sung at least by me since I was a small child. So I always love when Easter comes, because those two songs, you don't really ever sing them any other time of the year. So let's hear you as we sing He Lives. Thank you. not sure why this never stood out for me before, but the Easter story, you always hear, you know, that Jesus died on the cross and it's for our sins. But the thing that just really stood out for me today is, especially in this song, you know, it also means that he's alive for us so that he walks with us and he talks with us. And so I encourage you this week to spend time with him and listen, because he's willing to talk to you and walk with you. And I think that's the thing that gives all of us comfort as we go through difficult times. Let's pray. Lord God, we just thank you what this day represents for each one of us and all that you've done and how much you love each one of us. So Lord, help us this week to look to you and be reminded that you desire to spend time with us just like we desire to spend time with you. And that is so comforting, at least to me, Lord, and I pray that that is something that is comforting to everyone who is listening this morning. Help us this week to look to you and be with you. We ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a great week.